Welcome to National Arts. I'm Mike Baker. Imagine Robert Prosky and sons John and Andrew in Thornton Wilder's comic tribute to the potency of love, The Matchmaker. Well, you get your wish on National Arts. Somewhere between hilarity and morality, Wilder has chosen the notion of drama as painless ministering. Who better to administer this new medicine than Robert Prosky as the dry goods baron Horace Vandegelder and sons John and Andrew as the rambunctious Cornelius and Barnaby.
Now do put your thoughts in order, Mr. Vandegelder. I cannot be upsetting and disturbing the finest women in New York City unless you mean business.
Oh, I mean business, all right, Mrs. Levi.
Well, I hope so, because, you know, you're playing a very dangerous game.
Dangerous, Mrs. Levi?
Yes, of course it's dangerous. And there's a name for it. You're tampering with these women's affections, aren't you? And the only way you can save yourself now is to be married to someone by the end of next week. So think that over.
Wilder's Matchmaker, in a way, was a deviation of sorts because it was a mix of social commentary as well as laughter, wasn't it?
Oh, very much so. Matter of fact, the play itself, one of Wilder's themes is the survival of the human race. In Skin of Our Teeth, he talks about that a great deal. But this play is a survivor. It started in England in the middle 1800s as a one-act play. Then it was done by sort of a boulevardier playwright in Vienna in the middle 1800s. Wilder adapted that to a play called Merchant of Yonkers, which was not successful. Then he added Dolly, which was the magic ingredient, and the soliloquies. And it was a huge hit as The Matchmaker. Then, of course, Hello, Dolly was adapted from that. Then Tom Stoppard went back to the original Viennese play and did a play called On the Razzle. So it's a survivor of a play.
It's interesting because Wilder, in a way, is showing us a new path, but he's not denigrating the old one.
No, not at all, no. It's interesting that he does show a new path in his works in our town, which was very unique in the staging for its period in the 30s. But he was interested in Chinese theater and the way theater works in Asia. He spent a lot of time in Italy, so he was a very well-rounded intellect when he wrote this.
I guess one way to shake off the nonsense of the 19th century was to make fun of it in a way, wasn't it?
Well, yeah, yeah, and we do it in our staging, and it's fun, it really is. You still have to make the characters believable, but I'm enjoying the rather melodramatic effects of discovering the men in the hat shop. It's fun to do.
It occurred to me that there are a great many classical elements within the context of Matchmaker. You have mistaken identity, you have the soliloquy,
yes.
A very old art form.
Mm-hmm.
You have cross-dressing.
Yes, you do. Mm-hmm. Yes, that's very popular in British theater in particular. The pantomimes always did that they did at Christmas. But there are other things. There are echoes of Molière. Mm-hmm. The scene between Dolly and myself in the first act has echoes of the miser. Indeed, I wear, you know, Vandegelder's going out to do his best to gain a wife. And I wear a girdle to look as bad. And we make a show of it. It's a fake girdle, incidentally. It's not practical. But that has elements of the dottore, the foolish older man. So there's a lot of that in it.
Now, about Mrs. Malloy, what do you think? Shall we call that subject closed?
No. No, not at all. I want to have dinner with Miss
Simple.
Simple. Yeah, but first, I want to make another call on Mrs. Malloy.
Oh, dear, dear, dear. And Miss Simple.
Yes.
Oh, what races you make me run. Very well. I'll meet you on one of those benches in the front of Mrs. Malloy's hat store at 4:30, as usual.
One of the positives here, obviously, is the fact that you can make the change from the miserly to the more plentiful aspects
yes.
of life.
Yes. In many of the farces, a character like Horace would end up very badly. But he doesn't in this. He rediscovers his own humanity.
You make a comment that the world outside one's head is much different than the one inside, and therein lies the value of the soliloquy, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. It does. It's Thornton Wilder's comment, yeah. Really. Yes, it is. The play, as in most of Wilder's works, is deceptive. It is a great deal of fun. It's enjoyable. Almost all of his works are. If you've read any of his novels, Theophilus North, for instance, is very pleasant, a very pleasant read. And then you begin to realize lines like, the world outside of your head is different from the world inside of your head. And the soliloquies in this. There's a great deal more than the farcical fun that you attract you to begin with. And the more you think about it, the more is there. Our town, for instance, is done by so many high schools, and rightly so. But it has a reputation as being a rather saccharine, sweet sort of play. It's anything but. It's a universal look at the survival of the human race.
There's a lot of comment about labor here, too. You make the remark that you're not worth much till you're 40, and we're essentially just paying you to make mistakes up till that point.
Right, and I have other lines that said, you pay those girls of yours too much. You pay them as much as men. Girls like that enjoy their work. Wages, Mrs. Malloy, are paid to make people do work they don't want to do.
And people are hissing you.
Yes, I'm glad. They should.
When I was your age, I got up at 5. I didn't close the store until 10 at night, and then I put in a good hour at the account books.
The world's going to pieces.
You elegant ladies lie in bed until 6. And then at 9 o'clock at night, you rush to close the front door so fast, the line of customers bark their noses. No, sir!
Andrew, all I can say is thank God for the union movement. Or you'd have never gotten out of that store.
No.
I would imagine it was like that. I mean, people had to work exceedingly long hours. There was no union movement. No one looked out for the local worker. And you never got out of your hometown.
No. I would have to agree with you on all those points. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it was probably work. I guess the equivalent of today would be working in some convenience store and doing like a 16, 17-hour shift and doing that 5-6 days a week. So even with the union movement, I guess there are still some similarities in today's world, but tough job.
I think Wilder was probably trying to tell us in some fashion to allow the young to have a life, to essentially embrace them, bring them in. Don't make them work to 40 before you take them seriously.
Oh, it's a great play for those sort of things. You know, it's almost a play that's a lot like a self-help book. you don't have to go and read all your Louise Hay and these, you know, help yourself books. Come and see this play, and I think you'll get a lot of nice tips of just how to lead your life, lead a more fulfilling, happy life. This play can help you do that.
I would think the big challenge for you would be to find all the youthful and exuberant gestures that are connected with a 17-year-old.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what a 17-year-old who's never gotten off the farm or essentially out of the stock room does. I mean, he's kind of unkempt and not a lot of social skills.
Right.
And you found all those things.
Yeah, I like to think of him as an unsupervised troll. And a lot of the spirit of a 17-year-old back then, under his circumstances, you go even farther back in age. Mm-hmm. You know, some 17-year-olds today extremely sophisticated and active in all sorts of ways that 17-year-olds just a few years ago weren't. And then when you go all the way back to the 1890s, 17-year-old can have the same attitudes and naivete of, say, a 7 or 8-year-old even.
You'll attend to the store as usual, and on Friday and Saturday nights, you'll remain open until 10. Now hear what I say. This is the first time I've been away from the store overnight. When I come back, if I hear of any foolishness, I'll discharge you.
What was the biggest challenge for you?
Playing the role and making sure that I didn't fall into a trap of acting 17, of playing 17, rather than creating genuine needs and realistic goals that this person would have and pursuing those. Because it's very easy to fall into a trap of, okay, now I'm playing a quality of naive, or I'm playing a young quality, rather than picking actual objectives and activities and actions that people actually do. So there's your challenge, and that's all through the play.
Yeah. I would think it would be tough to see things that are so commonplace to you as Andrew and try to put the wonder of Barnaby in them.
Yeah, yes, that too. There's lots of ways that you can do that. You use various acting techniques. knowing the nuts and bolts of it takes away a little of the magic, you know. So maybe I'll be mysterious.
You're going to have a mistress.
I'm too young, Mr. Vandegelder.
Not yours, death and damnation, not yours, mine. Hey, you hold your tongue until you're spoken to.
People who see the play always ask what happens to Cornelius and Barnaby after the show is over.
I think for Cornelius, my brother's character, I imagine through the play, the hints that the play gives you, he gets married to Irene Molloy, becomes Vandegelder's partner in business, and probably just from those things you could do, so he becomes a more, I don't know, respectable person in the community. I think Barnaby goes back to the Bran room.
But he has a young lady on his arm that's somewhere down the line. There might be a happy reunion.
Yeah, I think it's important to keep the differences between the two there. Cornelius does go on and get married to this woman, and that's what he was after the whole time. I think Barnaby's relationship with Minnie is much less sophisticated and a little more on the just starting to date
discovery.
Side. Yeah.
And we have the whole classical element of the happy couples in the end and the marriage that we see in Shakespeare and in classical theater.
Yeah,
too.
He ties up all the loose ends.
Yes, he does.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It must be fun working with your brother and your father.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the easiest thing about working with your family is you can make fun of them all the time.
Many congratulations, Mr. Vandegelder, and my compliments to the lady.
That's none of your business. Now get back to the store. You have any questions you want to ask before I go?
Mr. Vandegelder?
Yes, Cornelius.
Mr. Vandegelder?
Yes, Cornelius.
Does the chief clerk get one evening off every week?
So that's how you begin being chief clerk, is it?
John, it's clear from the outset that at 33 years of age, Cornelius is really ready for some risk and adventure, and it's just a matter of time, isn't it?
Oh, boy, is it ever. Yeah, 33-year-old virgin. That's a lot of stuff pent up. I mean, sexually, romantically, mysteriously.
Intellectually.
Intellectually, yes, absolutely. I think one of the things that sort of spurs the character is the fact that he realizes that he definitely will be partner and be a Vandegelder. But his example of a Vandegelder is Horace Vandegelder. And that last line that Pop has before he leaves in his red Captain Crunch outfit. I forgot exactly what it is, but it says, Cornelius asks for an evening free, and of course, he has this long tirade that ends with an evening free. If I had an evening's free, do you think I'd be what I am now? And he's...
Doesn't want to be what he is now,
Yeah,
he?
To Cornelius, that's like, that's my it. God, there but for the grace of God go I. And that's what makes him go, I gotta get out of here, you know.
Why do you think he heads off for New York? Is that the big bad city at
that's
that particular
Disneyland.
Junction?
Okay. That's just, the big bad city. It's everything. It's Oz.
And he really is to the point where he doesn't care about his job anymore, that the whole idea of risk and adventure has taken paramount importance over keeping his job.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that the director had this great phrase for it. He said, you know, blowing up those tomato cans is an act of terrorism. And I think in that last scene of the first act, he truly sees how empty his life is. And all that responsibility and money, it doesn't mean anything to any. At one point he just says, you know what, so what? We get fired from here, we join the army, you know? Just get out, you know?
What do you think kept people like Cornelius at the grindstone? Was it obviously the work, but was it also a certain fear of the unknown, do you think?
I think so. I also think it's a very American play. And I think it really is just the American work ethic. That idea that, you know, you work hard, because that's what God wants you to do. And that's how you make good. That's a good citizen. Just work hard.
And if you don't work hard, you're embroiled in guilt.
Exactly, right. You've got...
It's a terrible thing.
Exactly, an idle mind is the devil's playground.
Maybe Wilder's counseling us against that we must have some form of social life and outlet.
Right. I think that's, the whole play is about that. That I think Wilder, as an American playwright, was trying to say to America that, you know, gain and work is fine, but it's got to be balanced with adventure and and joy.
It must be fun to dance with your father. I mean, there are three things going on there. It's not only that you're dancing with your father, but you're dancing with the character. You're dancing with the character as another character. All these different levels going on at one time. It almost boggles the imagination.
Yes, it's actually very hard to keep a straight face. That's the one place that, you know, Pop's Polish. Uh-huh. And he polka'd most of his youth. And uh-huh. so, and the same woman who taught him the polka taught us to polka. So to get on stage with my father wearing a woman's clothes, polking, and then he does this wonderful yowl, you know, that sort of Polish, and sometimes he'll bring that into a recognition of who he's dancing with. And the first time he did that, we were on stage and I just lost it. Mm-hmm. Laughed right in his face. You know, it was like, he literally made this sound like, you know? And that was all over for me. I was just like...
An evening free. Ha! Do you suppose I had evenings free? If I had evenings free, I wouldn't be what I am now.
Maybe the biggest challenge for your character is the fact that you essentially address everyone as if you're paying them. Mm-hmm. Now all of a sudden you have to reverse roles in a way, and you have to address people with some compassion. That's yes. a big challenge as an actor, I think, here.
It is, and a lot is to be said for our director, too, because that last scene with Dolly is very important. She tries to give me back the purse, and I say, keep it, which is a big change. But I talk to the director, and there's a second keep it. And the second one is now in the form of a question. It's beyond money, it's beyond anything, but will you give me your heart? It's a question. I mean, that's what makes the scene.
It must be wonderful to work with your two sons.
It is fun to work with my sons. We get along very well. We get along well as a family. And what's so obvious to me when I see them working is that they're brothers. They're not brothers in the play, but they work all their businesses with each other, and they have a lot of fun and get a lot of laughs with it.
I'm sure you've told the story many times, but Hill Street Blues was a tremendous launching pad of sorts for you.
Yes, it was. I was doing Glengarry Glen Ross on Broadway at the time, and I had given notice there because I didn't want to play it too long. And then this thing came through, and I was hemming and hawing about it. I didn't know whether I wanted to do a series. I didn't know whether I wanted to go out to California for that long and that sort of thing. And Joe Mantegna said, well, you're in a Pulitzer Prize play, you've been nominated for a Tony, and you've been offered one of the best things. He says, it's just another troubled day in paradise.
Yes.
And it was.
You've been able to bring something special to each of the roles that you've developed in broadcast news.
Get me one shot at anchoring the weekend news. They've never seen me do that. It could turn it around for me.
I could do that this Saturday. Yeah, everybody went off for the correspondence dinner.
Do it then.
Please, prepare carefully. This couldn't happen at a better time.
Prepare what? You have Saturday's news handy?
Yeah, it's a long while since you read the news. I'll have somebody work with you on it. Just on superficial performance things. Please, please.
Okay. I think I'd better be alone for a while.
I understand.
I'll go with you. Thanks.
This is Doubtfire, across from the very energetic Robin Williams.
Can I help you, man?
Oh, sorry I'm late. But after all those scotches, I had to piss like a racehorse. Mm.
Daniel?
Yeah?
Why in God's name are you dressed like a woman?
Well, like you to meet the host of your new show.
In the most recent Scarlet Letter.
That was an interesting group of people. They had to be as morally strong as they were in order to survive. Now, they did some things later that weren't particularly admirable. But you understand the root, where it came from. At least I tried to find it anyway. There's one coming out, too, that I'll have to mention, which I think should be very good. It's with Susan Sarandon, And the first thing she asked me when we got on set is, how's Dick Bauer in Hello Wines? Because they all studied together at Catholic University, and I think they worked together in a touring group for some time. But it's directed by Tim Robbins, and he adapted the book. It's based on a book written by a Catholic nun called Dead Man Walking, about a condemned man. She was spiritual advisor to a condemned man in Louisiana.
You still got a judge in the federal court that could put a stop to this.
I forced you to be in the woods that night.
I told you, I was stoned out of my head.
You blame the government, you blame drugs, you blame blacks.
Get out of the car!
What about Matthew Ponsilin?
If all children ever want from their parents is a healthy imagination, both you boys certainly got a healthy imagination and a lot of great stories.
That's
and a lot
sure.
of great characters.
Sure. Well, dinner breaks were kind of interesting because it wouldn't take off all of his makeup or all of his costume. You only have 2 hours between shows. So, you know, you'd be eating dinner with, you know, just various characters throughout the year. I wasn't sure who you were eating dinner with. And that was enough to spur a child's imagination. Who's dad going to be this month?
We had a... very large antique mirror just opposite where Dad would sit to eat. And he could not help himself. He was forever making faces in this mirror. To the point where my mother was like, if you don't stop that, Mom. So he's got to the gopher face.
Okay. The fake gopher face. No,
I would make sure the nose go like.
I
don't remember that one.
Yeah, that
there
one.
It is.
Come
that's
on,
pretty
that's
good.
That's to awesome. An 8-year-old kid. That's great. That's like golden.
That's so how many of these faces and characters did you guys take to school?
Oh, as many as we could do. Well, pretty hard. Some of them, like that face, I still can't do. And his Donald Duck is still one of the things that I'm trying to achieve. He is a good Donald Duck.
When he did Thief, I was in high school. I went to Gonzaga. And he had a death scene where he was shot in the middle of the forehead and did these. And I remember in the cafeteria, there were always, my friends would take like a slice of pepperoni, slap it in the middle of their face and go, who am I? Brosky's dad.
I also played a caveman in a commercial.
Oh, I never heard the end of that one.
Oh, yeah.
The three of you on stage now, this you're not obviously new to stage together as a group. Are there any humorous moments that you all have shared?
The downstage lights are for me. Find what light you can.
I remember once watching Dad forget his line, but this was years.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. That's right.
I think I was 11 or 12, and I was playing Tommy in All Wilderness, and you were playing Nat.
Yeah, the father.
And we sat down at the dinner scene, and Dad's turn, everybody's looking over. Okay, your turn, buddy. And there he was, not saying a thing. And that was fun.
Did you jump in and save him?
No, I just watched him flounder.
You could see in that little face the whole idea of he's fallible.
Yeah,
he's not perfect.
The honest answer to that is I was scared.
I'm screwing up.
But he came down with the line. He, you know, he kept his cool and you remember what he was supposed to say. God bless him.
I'm obviously interested in the most impressive moment that you've ever seen your father in terms of performance. Do you remember what that might be?
I would have to say that the time and the end, the end of Death of a Salesman, when he's playing Willie Loman, when it all adds up before the character goes out and wrecks the car, kills himself. It's an arena stage, and he's the only one on. He's in the middle of the stage, and the way he played the moment, I should say, when it all added up, makes that exit. I remember, I was pretty young, but I still remember, wow, there's a lot of power involved in this. There's a lot of power. I can't really find a better word. Just impressed on me how powerful the art form could be in the right hands.
How about yourself, John?
I have two favorite moments. There's in Glenn Ross, when he's playing Shelley Levine in Mamet's play. He had this one moment where I probably can't say it because it is Mamet, but it was just this, he had just made this sale and he had this line that was just a string of profanities asking for more leads so he could go out again. And the way that he sat in the middle of the stage in the swivel chair with a cigar and just sang these F, C, and SH words was just like amazing. It was so funny and human and, you know, and the second moment is the end of Camping with Henry and Tom, when he played Tom Edison. I did that with him. And he has his struggle with that character's struggle culminates in the
remembering a kid's name who drowned when he was a child, and his remembering that name, I thought, was just beautiful, simple, and complex, and it's...
Well, what have you two learned from your dad? Obviously, boatloads, but I mean, from a professional acting point of view,
when you're acting with him, stay the hell out of the way.
And be ready for anything.
The downstage lights are for him.
Seriously?
No, I'm kidding.
Be ready. Be ready for anything, because he will throw it to you.
Stay liquid, that's what I would say.
Number of different ways.
He's very different than any actor his age. He stays very liquid, very loose. Always moving, always
changing.
It's very
fresh. It's very fresh.
Yeah, spontaneous.
With all those years of experience, it doesn't suffer.
I hope you enjoyed seeing the love and honesty that can exist between a father and his sons. It can certainly be heartwarming and entertaining. Until next time, remember, art was meant to be appreciated, so you be a part of it.